Last week, in our class of the tafsir of the Quran to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we looked at the incident or the incident surrounding tahweel al-qibla, min bayt al-maqdis ila masjid al-haram, from bayt al-maqdis to masjid al-haram. And we mentioned in last week's class that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam salla, he prayed towards bayt al-maqdis for how long? Sitta ashar shahran aw sab'ata ashar, for 16 to 17 months. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was praying towards the direction of Baytul Maqdis. And in the first era, the Meccan era, this was not an issue at all for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Reason being, the way the Kaaba is, you could face anywhere, but yet the Kaaba, if you're in Masjid al-Haram, it will still be in front of you. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will face the Kaaba between Hajar al-Aswad and Rukn al-Yamani, but facing where? Baytul Maqdis, facing Bilad al-Sham. So it was not an issue. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated from Mecca to Medina. Then it became an issue because Mecca or Medina was between Mecca and Baytul Maqdis. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he faced Baytul Maqdis, his back would be turned towards where? Towards Masjid al-Haram, to the Kaaba. And if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced the Kaaba, his back would be turned to Baytul Maqdis. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam therefore chose to face Baytul Maqdis. And why was it that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced Baytul Maqdis instead of Masjid al-Haram? Why? Naam? Because? Barakallahu fi. Because Ahlul Kitab, that when a Sharia does not come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the initial stages, when no laws or orders come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to love to do things in conformity to the way of Ahlul Kitab, because their religion has a basis and it has an origin. And Ahlul Kitab, they used to face Baytul Maqdis. And who from the Ahlul Kitab? Al-Yahud. The Jews used to face Baytul Maqdis. So therefore the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did it in conformity to them. However though, although he was doing that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam yearned and he wanted to face Masjid al-Haram. But because it was an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he kept facing Baytul Maqdis. And not only did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam want to face Masjid al-Haram, in fact there was Sahaba that wanted to face Masjid al-Haram. And even before these verses were revealed to change the direction of the Qibla, there was a Sahabi radiallahu an that used to pray in the direction of the Kaaba. In fact, it was said he was the first person before the order came down to pray in the direction of the Kaaba. And what's the name of the Sahabi radiallahu an? Bara ibn Ma'rur. He was the first. Until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered him and said to him, لو صبرت كنت على قبلة ولكن لو صبرت. Indeed, you face the Qibla, meaning the Kaaba, but be patient until the revelations revealed. But he passed away before the revelation concerning Tahweel al-Qibla, the changing of the Qibla. However, upon his deathbed, he told his wife to turn his body before he passed away in the direction of the Qibla. So they said this Sahabi radiallahu an was the first to face the Qibla hayyan wa mayyitan, dead and alive. The first to face the Qibla. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, kunta ala qibla. He was upon the qibla anyway, but you be patient for the revelation. Now last week, we didn't explain this part of the hadith. Kunta ala qibla. He was upon the qibla. He was upon the qibla because a qibla or qibla al-asliya, Masjid al-Haram al-Ka'aba. The original qibla is where? Masjid al-Haram, not Baytul Maqdis. And why is the original qibla Masjid al-Haram, the Ka'aba, in the first place? Because أول بيت وضع للناس, the first house that was established for the worship of mankind was where? The Kaaba, Masjid al-Haram. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, he raised the foundation of the Kaaba. He's not right, raised the foundation. As for Baytul Maqdis, who built Baytul Maqdis? Ya'qub. And who is Ya'qub to Ibrahim? Grandson. So between Masjid al-Haram and or the Kaaba, the raising of the foundation of Kaaba and Baytul Maqdis were 40 years. So the original Qibla in the first place is where? The Kaaba. Secondly, they say it's not only the original Qibla, it is the only Qibla, some say, which is the Kaaba. But the most sahih opinion, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, the original Kaaba, or the original Qibla, afwan, is the Kaaba. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, although he yearned this, he followed the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Until the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came down, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ, that we have seen the constant rotation of your face, or your face looking at the sama, looking at the heavens. When this order came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then he started to face the where? The Kaaba. And he said this order came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the first salah that was prayed facing the Kaaba, some say salatu fajr, and some say salatu al-asr. And when this order came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, one of the people that prayed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he passed by a masjid of people, and he said to them, "Ashhadu billah, laqad sallaytu ma'a Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wasallam qibla al-Kaaba." He said, "I swear to you by Allah, I've prayed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they prayed in the direction of the Kaaba." And when he said this to the people, and this is a proof of what? That we as Muslims would accept ahadithul ahad. Narrations that are narrated by one or two people, it suffices. It doesn't have to be mutawatir. When he said this to them, what did the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, what did they do? They turned immediately and faced the direction of where? Masjidul Haram. The direction of the Kaaba, Masjidul Haram. And here, what's more amazing is they were actually in salah, in the ruku'. They turned in ruku' and faced Masjidul Haram. So from there on, it became an obligation to face Masjidul Haram. Then, other than the incidents, we went on to the explanation of the ayat. And we said, from now on, we're going to be looking at rules and regulations. Why? Because a lot of rules and regulations came down where? In Medina. So this ayah, لَقَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ, there's a lot of rules and regulations. Rules and regulations of fiqh. And when we say fiqh, we mentioned last week, mean fiqh in its general terms. Because anything that enters into understanding of the religion is fiqh. And the greatest fiqh is the fiqh of what? Fiqh tawheed, fiqh aqeedah. That's why Abu Hanifah rahimahullahu ta'ala called his book Fiqhul Akbar, the greatest fiqh in aqeedah. So when we're talking about rules and regulations, aqeedah is going to enter into it. So we start with saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ وَحَيْثُ مَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرًا وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ لَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا يَعْمَلُونَ. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that قَدْ نَرَى, indeed we have seen. The first rule, or the first, not rule, rather, the first benefit from this ayah is what? Allah ta'ala said, we have seen. But, literally, نَرَى, it means we see. Jumla, or فعل مضارع, فعل المضارع, it's a present tense, a present simple, something which is simple, we see, but in reality Allah, he saw. So he said the first benefit from this ayah is what? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing something that happened in the past with a present tense. Why? لِأَنَّ ذَلِكَ الْأَمْرُ تَكَرَّرَ, because it was repeatedly done by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So because it was repeatedly done, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? A present simple that denotes something which is habitual, that he constantly looked at the where? The heavens. So the fact he did so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we continue, we see. And we got from this ayah as well, قَدْ نَرَى إِثْبَاتُ رُؤْيَةُ اللَّهِ, the affirmation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a very important point in aqeedah, Allah, he sees. And we say ru'ya is of two types. Ru'yatul ilm, seeing according to knowledge. For example, I say, do you see what I'm saying? Mean, do you understand what I'm saying? And then there's ru'ya al-haqiqiyya, there's real ru'ya, ru'ya bil-basa, with the sight. Like the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, qad nara, I see. So how do you differentiate between, when you read in the Quran, between a ru'ya bil-basar or ru'ya bil-ilm? How do you differentiate if it's a sight based on knowledge or sight based on real sighting or something? This is your homework. Huh? There's a context of the ayah, barakallahu feek, like the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alam tara, did you not see? كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. According to the context, the Prophet ﷺ was born when? Amul Fil, he would not have seen. But have you not seen? Do you not understand? Do you not have knowledge? But however, there's one thing that is common in all of these ayah for you to know between ru'yatul basar, seeing, real seeing, and seeing meaning understanding. And if you read this ayat, inshallah ta'ala, from a linguistic point of view, you see it. So that's your homework. Next week, whoever brings it. That when you look at ayah, ru'yatul basar, look at it in Arabic, there's one thing that will point it out to you immediately, linguistically. You know what? Knowledge is mentor or real sighting is mentor. So this is a homework for next week, inshallah. Tayyib. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ithbatu ru'ya, nara taqalluba wajhika fis sama. From this ayah, a lot of ahkam. Wajhika fis sama. And we said this is also proof of what? Uluwullahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a proof of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, aliyun, huwa al-a'la, the highest. And we said the loftiness and the highness of Allah is of two types. And what are the two types? Uluwa al-dhat, Allah ta'ala physically is above all things. Wa ulu al-ma'na, and in meaning and attributes and characteristics, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above all things. Fi sama, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say yamina wa shimalan, because he said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taqallub wajhi, for him to look at the heavens, he was making dua. Wa qibla to dua is where? The heaven. Tayyib. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we're going to give you a qibla which you please with. Fawalli wajhaka shatra al-masjid al-haram wa haythuma kuntum fawallu wujuhakum shatra. And wherever you are, turn your faces to the direction of Masjid al-Haram. So the first khitab was to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that fawalli wajhaka, turn your face. And the second address is to the ummah, wujuhakum. So from this, we got one point of benefit, that any address in the Quran to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are of three types. Specific to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jayid, specific. Give me an example of an ayah which is specific to the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Anjum, Sheikh Anjum. And we studied this before, those ayah or ayah which is specific to the Prophet ﷺ, khas bil Rasul, yani al khitab. Salman. Sorry? La. That is specific to the Prophet ﷺ, khitab lahu. خاص example أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكْ إِنْشِرَاحُ الصَّدْرِ, the physical space of the chest was who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there's some ayat which is مُوَجَّهَة. There's difference between khitab, addressing, and directing. There's some khitab which is directed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the rest of the ummah. And an example of this is what? يا أيها النبي إذا طلقتم النساء فطلقوهن. Allah Ta'ala said فطلقوا. Divorce them, all of you. So this is directed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the rest of the ummah. And there's some khitab that is addressing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam only. And the difference amongst the scholar is whatever is addressing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, does it also address us or directed to us? Some of the scholars say yes, because he's the leader of the ummah. So therefore, it represents us. Whatever is addressed with, we're addressed with, unless there's proof. And the other scholars say, no, it's only for him, the address. However, it's directed to all of us, because we have to follow his examples. Just ikhtilaf al-lafzi, in terms of wording. Jayid? So we got this from the ayah as well. فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. So turn your face towards Masjid al-Haram. Now, the fact this is directed to us, we took from this ayah, that it's an obligation. Naam. Barakallahu feek. There's one which is directed, ruling to him and the rest of the ummah. And the third one is, the ulama say, it is only for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, it's only for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also, he's the one being addressed. Only being addressed, but also the ummah is being addressed. Jayid? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it an obligation, but it's ayah to face the general direction of Masjid al-Haram. So going to the rules and regulation, we have to face direction of Masjid al-Haram. We don't have to face exactly the Kaaba, because you can't see the Kaaba. But the ruling is to face the general direction of Masjid al-Haram. So therefore, based on this, If a person was to go a little bit to the left, a little bit to the right, it's not an issue. But the issue will be if the Kaaba is to the left of you and you're praying towards the right, or the Kaaba is in front of you, or Masjid al-Haram, sorry, the direction of Masjid al-Haram is in front of you, and you're praying towards the back. That's when it becomes an issue. That's when it becomes an issue. But to go a little bit like this, a little bit like that, that's not when it becomes an issue. And the proof of this is the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Ahlul Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma bayna al-mashriq wal-maghrib qibla." Whatever is between the east and the west, that's specific for the people of Medina, because of their direction. Whatever is between the east and the west is the qibla. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, also the hadith we discussed last week, "La tastaqbilu qiblata bighaitin wala bawlin wala tastadbirha." تستدبروها ولكن شرقوا أو غربوا. Do not face the direction of the Qibla with غائط, with defecating or urinating. However, the Prophet ﷺ said, ولكن, nor should you turn your back to the direction of that direction, defecating or urinating. ولكن, however, turn to the east and the order or the west. جيد. However, facing the Qibla or facing Masjid al-Haram is an obligation except in three circumstances. Three circumstances you don't have to face the direction of Masjid al-Haram. And those three circumstances are number one, عند الخوف, at the time of fear. At the time of fear. For example, you're fleeing from an enemy. طيب, you face any direction you can. جيد. Number two, العجز, inability. For example, a person is ill and is upon a bed, hospital bed, for example, and there's nobody to turn him in the direction of the Qibla. He prays as he is. But when we're saying inability, a time of sickness, that's an example. It doesn't mean inability is only a time of sickness. There's other inabilities. Who could give me an example of another inability where you prayed and you don't know? Being paralyzed, barakallahu feek. Another example? Traveling. When you're traveling and you're not able, for example, you're on a plane. Some planes like Saudi Airlines or some other airlines, they actually show the direction of the Masjid al-Haram, of the Qibla. But depending whether they've made space for you to be able to pray, like Saudi Airlines, they should take out seats with a little musalla at the back, you could pray. You cannot always do it. So you pray and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. What's another example of inability? Al-ilm, knowledge. For example, the time of Asr is about to leave and Maghrib is about to enter, but you don't know the direction of the Qibla. You don't know. You've done all your ijtihad, you pray. You have to pray on time. The time has a precedence. You're unable to know where the direction of the Qibla. The third exception is an-nafila fi safar, voluntary prayers when you are traveling. An-nafila fi safar. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to sit on his riding animal, and wherever he turned him for nafila, he would pray. So people should not confuse obligatory prayers with voluntary prayers. There's some people, when they're traveling, they believe, subhanallah, any direction I could just face, because the Prophet did it when he was traveling. No, if you're able to face the Qibla, face the Qibla. But for voluntary prayers, you're allowed to on travel, not as a traveler, fi safari, on travel, you're in a car, you're on a coach, you're on a plane, you're on a train, you want to pray a voluntary prayer, you could do so. Jayid, fi safari, upon your journey. Jayid, not just generally, okay, I'm traveling, I could face the action of the Qibla. For example, I was on a train in Nigeria, and the train, they had an area where people could pray. Jayid, and usually it's in one kind of like direction sometimes. Jayid, it's an obligatory prayer. If you're able to, then you face that. And if you can't, fear Allah to the best of your ability, you face everywhere, you could find a space and pray. Where you could make sujood and so on and so forth, if it allows you to do so, then you pray. Tayyib. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the benefits of the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after saying to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ لَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقْ مِ رَبِّهِمْ. As for those, أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ, that inherited, or the people of the book before you, they know annahu al-haq. But not they know, but rather la mutawkid. They definitely, with a surety, they know it is truth from their Lord. It is a truth from their Lord. And what is the proof that they know for a fact is proof from their Lord, but yet they do not follow? What is proof of this? The proof of this are those majmu'ah, those groups of ayat we took before this. And that's why we say we're studying the tafsir according to order of revelation, because it'll make you understand in what context this ayat were revealed. And the groups of verses that was first sent down upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina was concerning what? Ahlul Kitab. The first of those ayah was what? فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. So the Prophet ﷺ, he came to an environment for the first time, Ahlul Kitab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the nature of Ahlul Kitab, especially the Yahud, and went through this, their different attributes. And one of their first attributes was what? Al-Kitabah. They write down things and claim it was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jayyid? So therefore, they know, but they write down things. And that's why some of the ulama say, even Baytul Maqdis, although it was built, not only was it not the original Qibla, some of the ulama say it was not the Qibla at all. This is something they wrote themselves. Secondly, from their attributes, Tahriful Kalim, distortion of words. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُ لَكُمْ. Do you have any hope they're going to believe in you? وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ. That a group of them, they distort the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though they know, from after they heard it, they distort the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ مِّنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوهُ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. After they've comprehended it and they know they're distorting the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah ta'ala telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they know for a fact. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the verses before that also said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ. That when a messenger comes to them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that which is with them, is confirming it and affirming it, نَبَذَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَرَاءَ ذُهُورِهِمْ. That a group of people from the book, they will hide or throw the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala behind their backs. كَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. As though they do not know. But here Allah ta'ala said, so they definitely know. So they definitely 100% know أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. It is the truth from their Lord. And this is a reality in the time we're in today, that they know for a fact, especially the scholars of Ahlul Kitab, that this is the truth from your Lord. I remember one time, I've mentioned this story many times, I was on a train, before understanding Arabic, there was a book, it was about marriage. I wasn't married then, so I was reading about the fiqh of marriage. So this book is called, it was written in Arabic, but I couldn't read Arabic then. It was written in Arabic, the front, but it was translated to English, Kitab al-Nikah, the book of al-Nikah. So I was reading it on the train, and one old man was sitting next to me, it was maybe the 70s or maybe 80s, very old. He was sitting next to me. And he said, you know, he took the book from my hand and he started to read the title in Arabic, Kitab al-Nikah. And he said, I'm a Jew. And he looked what people say typically may look like a Jewish person. He said, I'm a Jew. And he said, yeah, and he's summarizing all in his own words, that this religion is the truth. It covers every single thing. But yet he said, I'm a Jew. But he said, this religion is the truth. I remember some of the people that irritate you, wind you up in Hyde Park when you go there for da'wah. One day there was an argument, and there was a Jewish man there, like laughing. And Subhanahu Malik al-Quddus, he said in his own word exactly the ayah. He was saying it to my cousin. He said, Subhanallah, he said, these people are arguing with you. And he was laughing. He said, we know what Muhammad came with is the truth. We know Muhammad as we know our own children. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. And that's why of recent, there's a big, massive controversy where? In the Catholic Church. Because of a statement that's been attributed to the who? The Pope. And what did he say? I thought it was a hoax. You know, I thought it was a hoax. You know, these people send these WhatsApps. And then I actually, and it was the truth. He actually said it. Concerning who? Thank you. The Trinity or the divinity of Isa, the divinity of Jesus. Big controversy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنَّهُ That they know. أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِ رَبِّهِمْ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا يَعْمَلُونَ But Allah is not heedless of what they do. Meaning the fact that they know and they do not follow, they be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And next verse that follows that inshaAllah ta'ala is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That the fact that these people, they know is the truth. No matter what you say to them, no matter what you do, they're not going to follow you anyway. Because when somebody knows and is not confused, he knows is the truth, but it's very difficult to be guided. When you know something is truth and you do not follow it, it's difficult. But if you're confused, you have doubts, it's possible. And what causes this knowing the truth and not wanting to follow it? What causes it? Huh? Jazakallah khairan. Istikbar, pride. And this is one of the sifa of the Ahlul Kitab, the Yahud. And the sifa to Shaitan. Because what made Shaitan refuse? Aba wastakbar. He refused and he was proud and he was haughty. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam describing kibr, he said kibr is what? Raddul haqq. Is to refuse the truth. So that pride, he made them refuse it. Secondly, what makes you refuse the truth? When we describe the attributes of the Yahud, wa Ahlul Kitab, what made them refuse the truth? Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ كِتَابٌ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا That when a book came to them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and before that, يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ They used to claim they're going to be victorious over the mushrikeen, that a prophet is going to come. We're going to kill you and destroy you as Ad and Thamud were destroyed. Right? Remember this. They said, we're going to do this to you. The Yahud, they're waiting for the Prophet to come. فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمَا عَرَفُوهُ كَفَرُوا بِهِ فَلَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ الْكَافِرِينَ What's the other thing that caused them to do this? What causes them to like reject the truth other than pride? Asabiyya. Which in most cases, if you understand racism, nationalism, colorism, is born of what? Jealousy. Some people, they really, really hate you. Sometimes, racism, the basis of it, other than being pride, haughty, default in aqeedah, is really jealousy. It's jealousy. It could be about, okay, he's of this complexion, he gets a better job. هذا ما كتب الله له. It's a reality, but that's what Allah Ta'ala is waiting for him. Or, أعوذ بالله من ذلك, as they say, they're going to take all our women. Jayid? So the Yahud, one of their sifa is hasad. That's what Allah Ta'ala said, وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّونَكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ They wish they could make kuffar. Why? حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ Out of jealousy which is in their souls. مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الْحَقِّ After the truth has been made clear to them. So the issue of tahwil qibla, it's not about them facing the qibla. They don't mind that. The issue is, in facing the qibla, what does it show? They followed who? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is why racism, nationalism is a danger. Why? Because you reject the truth due to your pride, because of who it is coming from. You reject the truth based on your jealousy, because I don't want to be seen like I'm following that individual. So this was the issue. Hasada min indi anfusim. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fact that they already know the truth, is different to the Christians. They were people that worship Allah upon ignorance. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them, that from amongst them are worshippers, people that are devoted. When they hear the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their eyes will flow with tears. As the people of Najashi, the priest of Najashi, when he read from Surah Maryam, yeah, their beard became what? Wet with tears. And even what they were holding from the Bible was wet with tears. Because they're ignorant people, but people that know and they don't follow, it's very difficult. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِنْ أَتَيْتَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ بِكُلِّ آيَةٍ Even if he was to bring every single proof to them, مَا تَبِعُوا قِبْلَ They will never follow your qibla. They will never. And that's why I say in Baqarah, there are people that there's hope for. And there's people there's no hope for. And that's what Allah ta'ala says, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَنْ يُؤْمِنُ لَكُمْ Because you don't give up da'wah, hope of da'wah of anybody. But these people, do you have any hope they're going to be? Believe? وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ And a group of people of them, they heard the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they distorted it after they understood and they knew. So a person that knows and he's stubborn, he doesn't say, you know what, I'm not following. So some people know the sunnah, but they don't follow. But they don't have an issue with those who follow. They're like, you know what, I'm just weak. But a person that really knows, and you know he knows, it's a road of khalas. It's sometimes a road of no return. And some of these people, they know it. It's a road of no return. But instead of turning back, the pride stops them from turning back. And an interesting example like this is how knowledge, subhanAllah, Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned that people that know and they fight against it, Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, ذَمُّ مَنْ عَلِمَ الْحَقِّ وَلَمْ يَتَّبِعْهُ. The blameworthiness, or a person that knows the truth, but yet he doesn't follow it. And this them is not just an easy them. Even the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ كَلْبٍ. His example is like the example of what? A dog. And what is this ayah? Who is this ayah revealed concerning? A person from the greatest of scholars. Jayyid, at the time of Musa alayhi salam. They said this person, he had dua ul mustajab. That Allah Ta'ala said, Lo shi'na la rafa'nahu. If he wanted, we'll erase him. They said this individual was a siddiq. He had that level, martaba siddiqiyya. La rafa'nahu, we could raise him. What's above siddiqiyya? Nubuwa, prophethood. Walakin akhlad ila al ard. He stuck to the dunya. So this man was a scholar. They said he used to give a class. If he makes a dua, Allahumma anzil al-matar. Allah, let the rain will fall immediately. Some of them, the tafsir, I don't know if this is Israeliyat or not. They say when he gave the class, he could see the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to this level. So the Musa came to attack his people, alayhi salam. And Musa was a prophet, Jayyid. And the people went to him. His people said, no, Musa Nabiullah. Musa is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I could not make dua against them. And they kept going on and on and on and on until he fell into their trap. And he went to make dua against Musa. But every time he tried to make the dua, Allah would twist his tongue. And he said, Allahumma ahli qawmi, Allah destroy my people. At this point now, he knows he's wrong. But what did he say? He said, I've destroyed my dunya and akhirah. I might as well just go all the way now. Subhanallah. When you realize that dua is not going to work, then, subhanAllah, to show the fitna of women, they use this example of fitna of women. He said, to destroy the army of Musa, what you need to do, send the most beautiful of your women into his camp and make her, give her the best of makeup and adornments. And they sent this woman, and she destroyed the camp of Musa. How? When she got into their camp, one of the men, the armies of Musa, said, are these the women Allah Ta'ala has prohibited us from doing, fornicating with, adultery with, committing illicit behavior with? Musa said, na'am. He said, I'm going to do it. Right in front of Musa. And Allah Ta'ala inflicted a plague upon the whole army. Like the hadith of Rasulullah, when fawahish, illicit sexual becomes common, disease will appear amongst you that never existed amongst your people. Fitnat in nisa. Anyway, so Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala said, وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. So if you used to come, they would, مَا تَبِعُوا قِبْلَتَكَ. They will never forget your qibla. وَمَا أَنْتَ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُمْ. And what's the ayah? وَمَا أَنْتَ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُمْ. What's the translation of the verse? وَمَا أَنْتَ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَهُمْ. وَمَا بَعْضُهُمْ بِتَابِعٍ قِبْلَتَ بَعْضٍ. What's the translation? Because for the class, you should do your homework, right? The translation is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say to the Prophet you, he doesn't say, لا تتبعوا, don't follow their qibla. He didn't say that, do not follow their qibla. He said, ما أنت بتابع, you are not a follower. So for example, I could say here to our brother, I could say, do not go to the mall. But if I say you're a person that doesn't go to his mall, that's his constant characteristic. Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, constant, he never, and he always goes against what? Their ways. Subhanallah, there's a difference between do not do and a difference between you're not a doer of. A massive difference. This is more intense that you are not. Ma anta bitabi'in. You're not a follower of their ways. Meaning from now on, you're going to go, if they do it this way, you're going to do it that way. In the opposite completely. Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, and we'll end with this benefit inshallah ta'ala. There's more benefit from the ayat we'll do next week inshallah. Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, he said about this ayah that the benefit of this ayah is wujub mukhalafat al-mushrikeen. This ayah, ma anta bitabi'in, that if this is your constant, if this is the constant attribute of Rasulullah, it should be the constant attribute of who, the believer, the obligation for mukhalafa, to go against the way of the mushrikeen in that which is specific to them. Because Allah said, you never follow their way. in anything specific to them, you should never follow the way. وَلِهَذَا حَذَّرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِن مُشَابَهَةِ الْكُفَّارِ. And for that reason, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against following or copying the kuffar or emulating them. مَن تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever resembles or copies or emulates the people is from them. And we say that which is specific to them. So wearing a suit and tie does not mean you're copying them, because it's not specific to the kuffar. جيد. مَن تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. وقال, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, خَالِفُ الْمَجُوسِ. Go against or be different to the fire worshippers. وَفِّرُوا الْلِحَا. Keep your beard, allow it to grow, and trim the moustache. Subhanallah. Allow your beard to go, trim your moustache. So from the ways of the mushrikeen is either one or two things. Either they shave their beard or they leave their moustache to grow. So the issue of the beard, it enters into the issue of what? مُخَالَفَةَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And which is an obligation, that you have to be different to the mushrikeen. Jayid, keep your beard and trim your moustache. And that which is beautiful is that which Allah Ta'ala made beautiful. Wallahi. You know the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hatta akun basara alladhi yubsiru bi, I become his eye by which he sees with. And this is haram to do this. Why? Tashbih. But I become his eyes by which he sees with. Meaning a believer sees through the eyes of who? Eyes of Allah. Allah sees something with tayyib, he sees it with tayyib. And wallahi, ikhwan, anybody who's a lover of the sunnah, you see your brother sometimes, maybe he's young, maybe he's old, maybe from a certain nationality like Filipino, Malaysian, their beard doesn't really, you understand? Or even Abu Abdullah, he doesn't have a full beard from when I've known him, right? But to me, Allah ibarik fi, mashallah, wallahum barik, it looks very beautiful. I see some young brothers just going like this, but it looks so beautiful because you're seeing it through a different way. And we, if you don't have that iman, you ask Allah to give you that iman. Because Aisha radiallahu anha used to swear by Allah, who made a man beautiful with his beard. Allah Ta'ala said, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَاهُمُ اللَّهُ فَبِهُدَاهُمُ اقْتَدِي. These are the people Allah has guided. So follow their guidance. When he spoke about the Anbiya, and in the tafsir of the ayah, they said the sunnah of the Anbiya is the sunnah of the what? The beard. So that ayah, the sunnah of all the Anbiya, the greatest sunnah of the beard. And especially to the young brothers. Forget this nonsense. I want it to grow smoothly, I want it to go evenly, and all this rubbish, leave it. The Prophet says, "Afu liha." And you find some of the non-Muslims, that LeBron James, I don't know what they said, they have some big, like if you go to Philadelphia now, it's become a thing. Like, man, I have to put some oil on my sunnah, man. They call it the sunnah even. They go as far as calling the sunnah. They call it the sunnah, on my sunnah. Jayil? And he has other benefits, but the most important thing, wallahi, min mukhalafati al-yahud, especially for the young men, a'fu al-liha. Forget what people say, it looks like this, looks like that, but a person really sees, and even a person in his fitrah, even a non-Muslim, they see it to be a beautiful thing. So min mukhalafati al-yahud wa nasar wujub. And in other things as well, Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned from the other thing, the issue of hair. You could have the issue of haircuts and clothing is something which is what? Hil. Because the root of everything is halal. But if you know, for example, the thobe you're wearing now, if you know that this kind of clothing is famous or known for fusaq, you shouldn't wear it. So for example, some of the thobes have some design. It's okay. Nigerian thobe has design, it's okay. But if you know it's a specific set of people that wear these type of things, you shouldn't do it. And it's specific to the clothing, the fusaq and the kufar, you shouldn't do it. Things like, let's say, for example, sports gear. This is mushtarakun fi. This is something that everyone partakes in. Good, bad, evil. That's not that. There's things, yeah, that certain type of clothing, I don't want to mention them here. Certain types of clothing that by the label, by the sign, you know the kind of people that wear it. Certain types of dressing. For example, when I grew up in England, I used to have all these arguments with my parents, you know. You know Nigerians, the way they are, they want you to dress. Even if you're 40 years old, they're still in control of how you dress. You know, how you wear. So I remember the things that was in those days were things like chippy, which is very baggy jeans, right? And they had these shoes, raga, they used to call them, like three colors on them. I don't know if it was a copy of Bali, or ripped jeans, bleach. That was the thing in fashion at that time, right? And my parents used to go mad. And I understand why now. They used to go crazy. You can't wear this, you can't wear that. These are clothes for suck, so people wear this. And there was a reality to that, that the people that wore that kind of clothing, there were certain type of people, those very baggy jeans, that if you land off, if you fall off a cliff, it probably takes 2 weeks to land. Yeah. So now if you have people that wear their trousers, yeah, and it's hanging by their backside, what kind of people wear that? And what is the history behind that? Why do people wear their trousers like that? Because in the prisons, they don't allow you to have a belt, because you hang, some of them hang themselves or kill themselves. That's the history of it. So they're always pulling it up, right? But now he comes out of prison, but he's still got a prison mentality, and he's coming out with trousers hanging halfway down, and you find people copying this. Certain types of hairstyles, they're not respectable hairstyles. So my mom used to warn me, there was these string vests. There's nothing wrong with a vest, you know, the string vest, but my string vest had all the colors of the rainbows on it, you know? Red, green, black, you know those string vests, the t-shirt ones, right? And she'll be against it, no, you can't wear this, you can't wear that. SubhanAllah, as I became older, and with the discriminatory nature of the system over there, the what some people not realize, the institutional racism, dressing like that, I was more likely to get stopped. Dressing like that, likely to get stopped. Not only are you likely to get stopped, you're more likely to be arrested and even sometimes prosecuted for nothing. For nothing. I remember there was a friend of mine, the same jacket my father told me not to wear. The same exact jacket. Because those criminals, they used to wear it. There's a top type of jacket now, you wear it. Once you pull the hood over your head, it's got these dark glasses. Right? Why do you want to wear that? Why? Because when you have to make a move and go into a house quickly, they put that over their face and go and do what they have to do. That's why one of the sports brands was condemned recently with the thing they made where it covers your face. A famous sports brand. Because people that stab people, they pull that thing, CCTV, they had to pull it from the shops. So he was wearing exactly the same jacket, SubhanAllah. He was arrested, taken to prison for a crime. Yes, he didn't commit, because the people that commit, they're wearing exactly the same type of jacket. But he had a gold solicitor. The only thing that got him off, I don't know if his mother had sewn it or he always had it like that, the sleeve of his jacket was constantly rolled. So when they closed in on the CCTV, his solicitor, they said, "You can't be my client. His sleeve is like this." That's the only thing that got him off. So likewise, if you don't want people to judge you a certain way, do not dress a certain way. Do not have certain types of hairstyle. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. We stop here, inshallah ta'ala. This ayah, we'll finish the ahkam from it and then go back to the seerah next week, inshallah. Subhanakallah, bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.